Hi, my name is Shah. Like Paul mentioned, I do a lot of data visualization and mapping at Trulia. But what we kind of did in the past 2 weeks was last Tuesday and this past Monday, Trulia, O'Reilly Media, Hacks and Hackers, and Fast Company's Co.Design worked together to host a data visualization workshop for journalists, simultaneously in San Francisco and in New York. And we talked about a lot of the tools and processes and workflows of how to work with data, how to visualize data, how to map data. But we also talked about the why and the what. And that's kind of what I'd like to talk to you about today. Why is data visualization not just cool, but important? And for me, the why and the what kind of starts with this image. We all know what this is, right? These are plastic bottles. If we had more time, maybe more patience, we could count these. I kind of know how many shopping carts this might fill. But if we zoom out on this image, it changes. This is a piece by Chrys. This is a collage of 2 million plastic bottles, which is the number that the US goes through every 5 minutes. And to me, this image is less about how much we consume and how much we produce, and more about the vastness of our world today. What Seth talked to about the mountains of information. And you know, it also speaks to our inability to comprehend this scale, this world that is so vast. And Bill McKibben actually wrote about this a long time ago. Bill McKibben now is a pretty famous environmentalist, but in the 80s he was a writer. He wrote this essay for The New Yorker called The Apartment. And he traveled the world to kind of look at all the infrastructure, looking at oil fields and hydroelectric dams. And what he starts to talk about is that our language, the words we use to describe scale, start to fall apart. He talks about eating a big lunch next to a big dam, and how do we even start to, you know, describe things anymore? What does the word big mean in this context? And this writing of this essay, this traveling around the world, changed Bill McKibben's perceptions because he started to understand scale in a way. And if anything, you know, what we have these days are big issues. You know, Jan talked about them with drunk driving. We have, you know, all these kind of issues these days. Things that are kind of too vast to comprehend. And why I think that's important in terms of data visualization, I think of actually of this project. It's called If It Were My Home. And this outline is familiar to you guys, right? This is the Gulf oil spill. And I've kind of seen this reproduced across, you know, a countless number of newspapers, read a bunch of statistics on this stuff, millions of barrels and things like that. But what this project does is it allows me to type in an address and move it to your home. And so when I typed in my address in San Francisco, this happened. All of a sudden, everything I know and understand about the Bay Area is swallowed up by it. This very familiar outline of the oil spill has turned into something almost menacing. And the scale of this oil spill has turned visceral. It's not numbers anymore. It's not printed images. And if we move it over DC, I wonder how many of your commutes are lost in this oil spill. How does that change when we look at something not through words and numbers, but through images, through visualization? And Santiago Ortiz, a kind of fellow data visualizer, he went through this experiment to kind of see how many ways he could visualize two numbers. He came up with so many ways that he started to say that visualization is a language. It's is as expressive as what we write in. And I would like to just end and kind of take this quote and expand it and say that data visualization is a language of scale. It can fill in, it's a language that can fill in where Bill McKibben found ours lacking. It's a way to start to understand these vast things about our world, about how complex it is, about how fast it is. And I think it's an extremely powerful tool for us moving forward. So thank you. And Chrys is going to talk a little bit now about data journalism.
Thank you, Shah. So as Shah said last week, four groups got together to host a workshop about data journalism. And one of those groups is Hacks Hackers, which brings people together at the intersection of journalism and technology to explore and innovate and create new solutions for journalism. I was asked to speak about data journalism, and I guess you must be wondering, what is data journalism? Lots of people, including journalists themselves, have different opinions about what it is. You're going to find blog posts about it, there are entire websites about it, and nowadays there's even universities that give degrees in it. But there are even big conferences where the keynote talk is, what is data journalism? So most of us understand what journalism is, what news is, but data journalism? Me, I think it's a new buzzword for a very old process, gathering, examining, and finding meaning within collections of information and letting people know. So let's talk about data. You're probably familiar with that word, data, and you're probably thinking data means numbers. You're right. Piles of numbers. But there's other kinds of data as well. Factoids, video, photos, points in space, names and locations, time logs. These things that we collect, electronic files that we save that may not seem individually relevant or interesting, but when interconnected and cross-referenced and analyzed, they show us patterns and tell us stories and reveal truths. Why is access to data important? You get up in the morning and you're getting ready for work and you ask, okay, should I take my car or should I take the metro? Should I take the highway or drive surface streets? And luckily, the local transportation agency is giving you data. I mean, imagine how much more frustrating it would be if you had no idea what the traffic was like, right? Or what the subway system was doing if you didn't get a traffic report or a subway alert at all. Imagine how disastrous it would be if public safety officials didn't know where emergencies were happening. That's just one example, but you get the picture. Access to data is important because it keeps us informed when we need the information most. But it can also help us in hindsight. We can use data to understand how things happened and why. It can also help us for the future. It gives us something to work from so that we can improve outcomes, create safer conditions, and propose new ideas. But if the data isn't available in an easy to access, easy to examine electronic format, that just makes the work harder. And I'm not just talking about getting a stack of documents that you have to scan into a computer. In journalism, we sometimes talk about bad data or messy data. And it's data that can't be easily imported into the software we use to organize it. For example, PDFs. PDFs make it really hard to do data journalism. But there are other examples as well. Spreadsheets that have missing information, text files that have multiple ways of spelling one thing, or typos, or files with meaningless garble in them, messy data. It's important to have clean, structured, easy to find data because journalism is about getting things right while beating the clock. And even if you're not a journalist, I'm sure you're familiar with this kind of need for speed. The quicker we can get to the examination and analysis stage, the faster we can see the patterns and unearth the stories and explain what happened. With data, journalists are producing all kinds of things that help people understand complex issues. Maps explaining the seriousness of national drought, charts and interactive graphs that show the relationship between money and politics, games that really bring home what terms like distracted driving mean. Data is at the heart of what journalism is, and the more substantive it is, the more organized it is, and the more easily accessible it is, the better we can understand the events that affect our world, our nation, our communities, and ourselves. Thank you.